please, Henry?
As the director.
Before we begin our little show, I would like to welcome you to the Sharon Tor Asylum. Dearest patrons, please take note of the locations of the exits nearest your seats. In the event of an emergency, please remain calm and exit the building. Our staff will direct you. If you need special assistance during an emergency, please inform our staff. Now, please turn off all communicative devices out of consideration for our patients. The use of any sort of recording devices is strictly prohibited. Flashes may start back our patients. Lastly, food and drink are not allowed in our hydrotherapy facilities. Go ahead.
As the director of the clinic of Sharon Tor, I would like to welcome you to this salon. To one of our residents, a vote of thanks is due to Monsieur de Sade, who has wrote and produced this play for your delectation and for our patient's rehabilitation. We ask your kindly indulgence for a cast never on stage before coming to Charenton. But each inmate, I can assure you, will try to pull his weight.
Danielle!
We're modern and like it, and we don't agree with locking up our patients. We prefer therapy through education and especially art, so that our hospital may play its part, faithfully following according to our lights the Declaration of Human Rights. I agree with our author, Monsieur de Sade, that his play set in our modern bathhouse won't be marred by all these instruments for mental and physical hygiene. Quite on the contrary, they set the scene. For in Monsieur de Sade's play, he has tried to show how Jean-Paul Marat died. And how he waited in his bath before Charlotte Corday came knocking at his door.
Already seated in his place, here is Mahan. Observe his face. 50 years old and not yet dead, he wears a bandage around his head. His flesh burns, it is yellow as cheese, because disfigured by a skin disease. And only water cooling every limb prevents his fever from consuming him. To play this most important role, we chose a lucky paranoid, one of those who've made unprecedented strides since we introduced them to hydrotherapy. The lady who is acting as his nurse, whose touch certainly made him no worse, is Simone Evrard, not Charlotte Corday. Marat and Evra united one day. They shared one vision of the just and true, and furthermore, they shared her money too. Here's Charlotte Corday waiting for her entry. She comes from Caen, her family landed gentry. Her dress is pretty, shoes chic, and you note she readjusts the cloth around her throat. Historians agree, so it's not lewd enough to say she's phenomenally pulchritudinous. Unfortunately, the girl who plays the role here has sleeping sickness, also melancholia. Our hope must be for this afflicted soul that she does not forget her role. Here comes Monsieur. Revolution's murderous insanity. He brings a touch of higher vanity. Though, as a well-known Girondist, his name is upon Marat's blacklist. He is handsome, cheerful, full of zest, and needs more watching than the rest. Jailed for taking a radical view on anything you can name. The former priest, Jahu, ally of Marat's revolution, but unfortunately, the censors cut most of his rabble-rousing theme. Our moral guardians found it too extreme. Liberty!
Liberty!
Ladies and gentlemen, our players are drawn from many social layers. Our singers, for example. Of these four, each must be classified as bottom drawer. And now, they've left the alcoholic mists of slums and gin cellars, our vocalists, Cuckoo-Ragoo, Popo, Cobo, and on the streets no longer, Rosilio. Now, meet this gentleman of high society, who under the lurid stars of notoriety came to live with us just 5 years ago. It is to his genius that we owe this show. The former Marquis Monsieur de Sade, whose books were banned, his essays barred, while he's been persecuted and reviled, thrown into jail, and for some years exiled. The introduction is over now. The play of Jean-Paul Marat can get underway. Tonight, the date is 13th of July, 1808. And on this night, our cast intends showing how 15 years ago, night without end fell upon that man, that invalid. And you are going to see him bleed and see this woman, after careful thought, pick up the dagger and cut him short.
Thank you. with our own bleeding hands. We'll ride on the bosses and storm through the walls while the prison gate told us where that last is all.
Come on now!
We're on the wall.
I call to the people of France.
Paul, please, be more careful. Look how red.
water's getting.
And what's a bath full of blood compared to the bloodbath still to come? Once we thought a few hundred corpses would be enough, and then we saw thousands were still too few. And today we can't even count all the dead. Everywhere you look, everywhere.
Ah,
there they are! Behind the walls, down in the cellars, up on the rooftops. Hypocrites. They wear the people's caps on their heads with their underwears embroidered with crowns. And if so much as a shock gets wounded, they squeal, "Beggars! Villains! Gutter rats!" Simone, my head's on fire. I can't breathe. There's a rioting mob inside me. Simone, I am the revolution.
Corday's first visit.
I have come to speak to Citizen Marat. I have an important message for him about the situation in Thorn, my home, where his enemies are gathering.
And we don't want any visitors. We want a bit of peace. If you've got anything to say to Marat, put it in writing.
What I have to say cannot be said in writing. I want to stand in front of him and look at him. I want to watch his body tremble and his forehead bubble with sweat. I want to thrust right between his ribs the dagger which I carry between my breasts. I shall take the dagger in both hands and push it into his flesh. And then I will hear what he has got to say to me.
Not yet, Corday. Ah, you have to come to his door 3 times.
Oh,
happening. You can't stop it happening.
Can't?
The people used to suffer everything.
Suffer.
Now they take their revenge. You are watching that revenge. And you don't remember that. You drove the people to it. Now you protest, but it's too late to start crying over spilt blood. What is the blood of these aristocrats compared with the blood the people shed for you? Many of them had their throats slit by your gangs. Many of them died more slowly in your workshops. So, what is this sacrifice compared with the sacrifices the people made to keep you fat? What are a few looted mansions compared with their looted lives? You don't care if the foreign armies you're making secret deals with march in and massacre the people. You hope the people will be wiped out so you can flourish. And when they are wiped out, not a muscle will twitch in your puffy bourgeois faces, which are now all twisted up in anger and disgust.
Monsieur de Sade, we can't allow this. You really cannot call this education. It isn't making my patience any better. They're all becoming, what's the word?
Overexcited.
Yeah. After all, we might have the public here. And so then that our patients are not social level.
We only show these people massacred because this indisputably occurs. Please calmly watch these barbarous displays, which could not happen nowadays. The men of that time, mostly now demised, were primitive. We are more civilized!
Victory. Now that their pleasures have been taken away, the guillotine saves them from endless boredom. Gaily they offer their heads as if for coronation. Is not that the pinnacle of perversion?
I've read in one of your books, de Sade, in one of your immortal works, that the basis of all life is death.
Correct, Mahat. But man has given a false importance to death. Every animal, plant, or man who dies adds to nature's compost heap, becomes the manure, without which nothing could grow, nothing could be created. Death is simply part of the process. Every death, even the cruelest death, drowns in the total indifference of nature. Nature herself would watch unmoved if we destroyed the entire human race. I hate nature. This passionless spectator, this unbreakable iceberg face that can bear everything. This goads us into greater and greater acts. Haven't we always beaten down those who are weaker than us? Haven't we torn at their throats with continuous villainy and lust? Haven't we experimented in our laboratories before applying the final solution? Let me remind you of the execution of Danes after the unsuccessful attempt to assassinate King Louis XV, now deceased. Remember how Damien's died? How gentle the guillotine was compared with his torture? It lasted 4 hours while the crowd goggled and Casanova at an upper window felt under the skirts of the lady's luxury. His chest, arms, thighs, and calves were slit open. Molten lead was poured into each slit. Boiling oil they poured over him, burning tar, wax, sulfur. They burnt off his hands. They tied ropes to his arms and legs, harnessed 4 horses to them, and then geed them up! They pulled at him for about an hour, but they'd never done it before, and he wouldn't come apart until they sawed through his shoulders and hips. So he lost the first arm and the second arm, and he watched as they did this to him. And then he turned to us and shouted, "Ah!" So everyone could understand. So when they tore off the first leg and the second leg, he still lived, though his voice was getting weaker. And by the end, he just hung there, a bloody torso with a nodding head, just groaning and staring at the crucifix, which the father confessor was holding up to him. That was a festival! That which today's festivals cannot compete. Even our Inquisition gives us no pleasure nowadays. Although we've only just started, there's no passion in our post-revolutionary murders. They're all official. We condemn to death without emotion, and there's no singular, personal death to be had. Only an anonymous, cheapened death, which can be doled out to entire nations on a mathematical basis until the time comes for all life to be extinguished.
Citizen Marquis, you may have fought for us last September, but we dragged out of the jails the aristocrats who plotted against us. What? You still talk like a grand seigneur. And what you call the indifference of nature is your own lack of compassion.
Compassion?
Ah, Matt! Now you are talking like an aristocrat. Compassion is the property of the privileged classes. When the pitier lowers himself to give to a beggar, he throbs with contempt. To protect his riches, he pretends to be moved, and his gift to the beggar amounts to no more than a kick. No, Matt, no small emotions, please. Your ideas were never petty. For you, justice for me, only the most extreme actions matter.
If I am extreme, I'm not extreme in the same way as you. Against nature's silence, I use action.
Action.
In the past, indifference, I invent a meaning. I don't watch unmoved. I intervene. And say that this and this are wrong, and I work to alter them and improve them. The important thing is to turn yourself inside out. And see the whole world with fresh eyes.
Marat's liturgy.
Remember how it used to be? The kings were our dear fathers, under whose care we lived in peace, and their deeds were glorified by official poets. Piously, the simple-minded passed on the lesson to their children. And the children repeated the lesson. They believed it, as anyone believes what they hear, over and over again. And over and over again. The priest said, "The kings are our dear fathers, under whose care we live in peace." Our love is international, universal. Our love embraces all mankind. We are all brothers, everyone. And the priests looked down into the pit of injustice turned their faces away and said,
"The kings are our dear fathers, under whose care we live in peace.
Our kingdom is not as the kingdom of this world. Our life on earth is but a pilgrimage. The soul lives on humility and patience, at the same time screwing from the poor their last centime. They settled down among their treasures and ate and drank with princes, and to the starving they said, suffer.
Suffer.
Suffer as he suffered on the cross, for it is the will of God, and anyone believes what they hear over and over again. So the poor, instead of bread, they do with a picture of the bleeding, scourged, and nailed up Christ. And they prayed to that image of their helplessness. And the priest said,
"The kings are our dear fathers, under whose care we live in peace.
Raise your hands to heaven. Raise your hands to heaven. Bend your knees and bear your suffering without complaint. Pray for those who torture you. For prayer and blessing are the only stairways which you can climb to paradise." And so they chained down the poor in their ignorance, so that they wouldn't stand up and fight their bosses who rule in the name of the lie of divine right.
Amen.
Throw the sword. I must interrupt this argument. We agreed to make some cuts in this passage. After all, nobody now objects to the church, since our emperor is surrounded by high-ranking clergy. And since it's been proved over and over again that the poor need the spiritual comfort of the priests, there's no question of anyone being oppressed. Quite on the contrary, everything's done to relieve suffering with clothing collections, medical aid, and soup kitchens. And in this very clinic, we're dependent on the goodwill not only of the temporal government, but even more on the goodness and understanding of the church.
If our performance causes aggravation, we hope you swallow down your indignation. And please remember that we show only those things which happened long ago. Remember, things were very different then. Of course, today, we are all God-fearing men!
Pray!
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 Oh, pray to him!
Pray!
Our Satan!
Satan!
Which art in hell, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in hell. Forgive us our good deeds and deliver us to holiness. Lead us! Lead us to temptation forever and ever.
Amen!
The regrettable incident you've just seen was unavoidable indeed, foreseen by our playwright, who managed to compose some extra lines in case the need arose. And please understand that this man was once the very well thought of abbot of a monastery. Should remind us all, as they say, that God moves like man in a mysterious way.
Before deciding what is wrong, what is right, first, we must find out what we are.
What?
I do not know myself. No sooner have I discovered something, then I begin to doubt it, and I have to destroy it again. What we do is just a shadow of what we want to do. And the only truths that we can point to are the ever-changing truths of our own experience. I do not know if I am hangman or victim, for I imagine the most horrible tortures. And as I describe them, I suffer them myself.
Suffer.
There's nothing that I could not do, and everything fills me with horror. And I see that other people also suddenly change themselves into strangers and are driven to unpredictable acts. A little while ago, I saw my tailor, a gentle, cultured man who likes to talk philosophy. I saw him foam at the mouth and raging and screaming attack with a cudgel a man from Switzerland, a large man, heavily armed, and destroy him utterly. Then I saw him tear open the breast of the defeated man, saw him take out his still beating heart and swallow it.
Stop! A bad animal. Man is a mad animal. I am a thousand years old, and in my lifetime I have helped commit over a million murders! And the earth spread. The earth is spread thick with squash humans. And we few survivors, we few survivors walk over a quaking fog of corpses. Always under our feet, every step we take, broken bones, ashes, matted hair, always under our feet, a mad animal. I am a mad animal. And prisons don't help. Chains don't help. I escape through all the walls, through all the shit and splintered bones. An animal. I am a mad animal. I have plans. I have plans. Oh, this itching.
This fever beats in my head like a drum. My skin simmers and scorches. Simone, dip the cloth in vinegar and water. Cool my forehead.
Matt, I know that you give up your fame and all the love of the people for a few good days of help. You lie in your bath as if you were in the pink water of the womb. You swim all huddled up alone with your ideas about the world, which no longer fit the world outside. And why should you care about the world outside? For me, the only reality is imagination. The world inside myself. The revolution no longer interests me.
Wrong, son.
Wrong.
No restless ideas could break down the walls. I never believed the pen alone could destroy institutions. However hard we try to bring in the new, it comes. Into being only in the midst of clumsy deals. We're all so clogged with dead ideas that even the best of us don't know the way out.
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 We invented the revolution, but we don't know how to run it. Look, everyone wants to keep something from the past. A souvenir of the old regime. This man decides to keep a painting. This one keeps his mistress. That man. Garden, he keeps his horse, he keeps his estate, he keeps his country house, he keeps his factories. This man couldn't part with his shipyards. This one kept his army, and that one keeps his king.
King.
And so we write into the Declaration of the Rights of Man the holy right of property. And now we find where that leads us. Every man is equally free to fight. Fraternally, and with equal arms, of course. And man against man, group against group, in happy, mutual robbery. And ahead of them, the great springtime of mankind. The budding of trade, and the blossoming of industry, and one
enormous financial upsurge. We stand here more oppressed than when we begun. And they think the revolution's been won.
Do not quit till this evening. everything will be too late.
Dearest Sharp, my place is here. How could I leave the city which holds you, dearest Sharp? My place is here.
And why should I run?
And why should I run? Now, when it can't hold out much longer, already the English lie off. Dunkirk, Toulon, the Prussians.
The Spaniards
have occupied the Roussillon, Captain.
Mayence.
Mayence is surrounded by the Prussians. Condé and Valenciennes have fallen to the English.
The Austrians.
The Vendée is up in arms. They can't hold out much longer, these fanatical upstarts. So no, Charlotte, here I stand. Until the judgment day, when with the Marat's mob interred, France once more speaks the forbidden word. Freedom. You hear that, Marat? Freedom.
Freedom.
They all say they want what's best for France. My patriotism's bigger than yours. They're all ready to die for the honor of France. Radical or moderate, they're all out of the taste of blood. The lukewarm liberals and the angry radicals all believe in the greatness of France. Matt, can't you see that this patriotism is lunacy? Long ago, I left the heroics to the heroes, and I care no more for this country than any other country.
Take care.
Long live Napoleon and the nation!
Long live all emperors, kings, bishops, and popes!
Long live the watery broth in the street gang!
Long live the
It's easy to get mass movements going. Movements that move in vicious circles. I don't believe in idealists who charge down blind alleys. I don't believe in any of the sacrifices made for any cause. I believe only in myself.
I believe only in that thing which you betray. We've overthrown our wealthy rabble of rulers. We've disarmed many of them. Though many escaped. But now, those rulers have been replaced with new ones who used to carry torches and banners with us and now long for the good old days.
Good old days.
It becomes clear that the revolution was fought for merchants and shopkeepers. The bourgeoisie, a new victorious class, and underneath them, ourselves, who always lose the lottery.
Peace.
can grab it now. Oh, wait 100 years and see what the authorities arrange. Up there, they despise you because you never had the cash to learn to read and write. You're good enough for the dirty work of the revolution, but they screw their noses up at you because your sweat stinks. You have to sit way down there so they won't have to see you. And down there in ignorance and stink, you're allowed to do your bit toward bringing in the golden age in which you'll all do the same old dirty work. Up there in the sunlight, their poets sing about the power of life. And the expensive rooms in which they scheme are hung with exquisite paintings. So stand up.
Stand up.
Defend yourselves from their whips. Stand up, stand in front of them, and let them see how many of you there are. The cleric you've been listening to is the notorious priest Jacques, who, to adopt a new religious fashion, has quit the pulpit and with earthier passion rages from soap boxes. A well-trained priest, whose rhetoric is slick to say the least.
Slick.
If you'd make paradise, your only chance is not to build on clouds, but on solid ground. The mob eats from his hand, so who knows what he wants, not what he should do. Talks cheap. The price of action is colossal, while who decides to be the chief apostle of Jean-Paul Marat? Seems good policy, since Marat's heading straight for Calvary and crucifixion. Good Christians know is the most sympathetic way to go. We demand the opening of the granaries to feed the poor. We demand the public ownership of workshops and factories. We demand the conversion of the churches into schools. So that now at last something useful may be taught in them. We demand that everyone should do all they can to bring an end to war. This damn it war, which is run for the benefit of profiteers and leads only to more wars. We demand that the people who started the war should pay the cost of it.
Yeah.
Once and for all, the idea of glorious victories won by the glorious army must be wiped out. Neither side is glorious. On either side, they're just frightened men messing their pants. And they all want the same thing. Not to lie under the earth, but to walk upon it without crutches.
Nowadays, it's best to preach revolution wearing a robe.
Marat, your hour has come. Now, Marat, show yourself. Go out and lead the people. They are waiting for you. It must be now. For the revolution which burns up everything in blinding brightness will only last as long as a lightning flash.
Marat! They need you because you are going to suffer for them. They need you, and they honor the urn which holds your ashes. Tomorrow, they will come back and smash that urn and ask, Marat?
Who's Marat?
Who's Marat?
Marat! Now I'm going to tell you what I think of this revolution, which I helped to make. When I lay in the Bastille, my ideas were already formed. I sweated them out,
under the blows of my own whip, out of hatred for myself and the limitations of my mind. In prison, I created in my mind monstrous representatives of a dying class who can only exercise their power in spectacularly staged orgies.
Orgies!
I recorded the mechanics of their atrocities in the minutest detail and brought out everything wicked and brutal that lay inside me. In a criminal society, I dug the criminal out of myself so I can understand him and understand the times that we live in. My imaginary giants committed desecrations, tortures. I committed them myself and, like them, allowed myself to be bound and beaten. And even now, I should like to take this beauty who stands there so expectantly and let her beat me while I talk to you about the revolution. All I can with my own strength. I turn myself away and watch what happens. Without joining him, observing, noting down my observations and all around me stillness. And when I vanish, I want all trace of my existence to be wiped out.
Wiped out.
smoke. Why is it getting so dark? Give me a fresh cloth for my forehead. Put a new cloth around my shoulders. I don't know if I'm freezing or burning to death. Simone, fetch Boss so I can dictate my call. My call to the people of France. Simone, where are my papers? I saw them only a moment ago. Why is it so dark?
They're here. Can't you see, Jean-Paul?
Well, where's the ink? Where's my pen?
It's your pen, Jean-Paul. Here's the ink, where it always is. That was only a cloud over the sun. Or perhaps smoke. You're burning the corpses.
One day it will come, a society which will foolish energy to defend and protect each person, for the possession of each person, so that all individuals, although united with all others, only obey themselves, and so stay free.
A society in which every man is trusted with the right of governing himself.
One day it will come. A constitution in which the natural inequalities of man will be subject to a higher order, so that all, however varied their mental or physical powers may be, by agreement, legally, get their fair share.
These lies.
Lies.
They tell about the ideal state. The rich will never give away their property of their own free will. And if by force of circumstances, they have to give up just a little, here and there, they do this only because they know they'll soon win it back again. Rumor spreads that the workers can soon expect higher wages. Why? Because this increases production and increases demand to fill the rich man's gold chest. Don't imagine that you can beat them without using force. As our revolution has been finally stamped out, they tell you things are better now. Even if there's no poverty to be seen, because the poverty's been hidden, and even if you ever got more wages and could afford to buy more of these new and useless goods which these new industries foist on you. And even if you thought that you never had so much, that is only the slogan of those who have much more than you. Don't be taken in when they pat you paternally on the shoulder and say, there's no inequality worth speaking of, and no more reason for fighting. Because if you believe them, they will be completely in charge in their marble homes and their granite banks, from which they rob the people of the world under the pretense of bringing them culture. Watch out, for as soon as it pleases them, they'll send you out to protect their gold in wars whose weapons rapidly developed by servile scientists will grow more and more deadly till they can, with a flick of a finger, tear a million of you to pieces.
Lying there, scratched, swollen, your brow burning, in your world, your back. You still believe that justice is possible?
Justice.
You still believe that all men are equal?
Equal.
Do you still believe that all occupations are equally satisfying, equally valuable, and that no man wants to be greater than the others? How does that old song go?
One always bakes the most delicate cakes. Two is the really superb monsieur. Three sets your hair with exceptional flair. Four is brandy goes to the emperors. Five knows every trick of advanced rhetoric. Six read a beautiful brand new rose. Seven can cook every dish in the book. And eight cuts you flawlessly elegant clothes. Do you think those eight would be happy if each could only climb so high and no higher before banging their heads on equality? If each could only be a small link in a long and heavy chain. You still think it's possible to unite mankind, when already you see how the few idealists who did join in the name of harmony are now out of tune and would like to kill each other over trifles.
But they aren't trifles. They are matters of principle.
Principle.
And it's usual in a revolution for the half-hearted and the fellow traveler to be dropped.
Dropped.
We can't begin to build till we've burnt the old building down. However dreadful that may seem to those who lounge in make-believe contentment, wearing their scruples as protective clothes. Listen. Can you hear through the walls how they plot and whisper? Do you see how they lurk everywhere, waiting for the chance to strike?
What has gone wrong with the men who are ruling? I'd like to know who they think that they are fooling. You told us that torture was already done. But everyone knows the same torture goes on. The keys don't obey. The prince of eternity. The nobles got their ears. Why are you getting
ready? What's going on here?
The men are fooling. The men are fooling. The men are fooling. So what's the torture? What's the men calling? And after them rules they see. Torture goes on.
Should be pulled. Their soup's burnt and they shout for better soup.
Better soup.
A woman finds her husband too short. She wants taller ones. A man finds his wife too skinny and he wants a plumper one. A man's shoes pinch, but his neighbor's shoes fit comfortably. A poet runs out of poems and blindly searches for new images. For hours, an angler casts his line. Why aren't the fish biting? So they join the revolution, thinking the revolution will give them everything. A fish, a poem, a new pair of shoes, a wife, a husband, and the best soup in the world. So they storm the citadels, and there they are, and everything's just as it was. No fish biting. Verses botched.
She was pinching.
A worn and stinking partner in bed.
Aww.
Soup's burnt.
And all that heroism which drove us down to the sewers, well, we could talk about it to our grandchildren.
Grandchildren.
If we have any grandchildren.
Threw himself down by my hand.
Yes, I see you, hated father, hated mother. What's that boat you're rocking in? I see you, I hear you! Why do you laugh like executioners?
To pull your favorite. Stop grinding, young fool! I will kill you! Lie still! You must take good care of yourself!
I'm not feverish. Now I see clearly those figures were always hallucinations.
Hallucinations.
Smog. Fetch Ba.
Fetch Ba.
My call. Ba!
Ba! When he was five, this loud mouth boasted, I can do anything a teacher. And what's more, I know more. And at 15, I've conquered all the universities and outdone all the professors. And at the age of 20, I've mastered the entire intellectual cosmos. That's what he boasted. As true as I stand here.
Simone, where are my manuscripts? My book, my novel on the young Constantine, and my book on the chains of slavery.
Leave all that stuff! It will only bring you trouble!
I want to see them. Look for them. Bring them to me.
Scribblings of a pickpocket. Pilfered thoughts, frivolities, tirades.
What book? Published under the name of a count. The other, under the name of just look at him.
Look at him.
This charlatan.
Charlatan.
3 foot high and court distinctions. Who turned on those? He was flattered. Only because they did not recognize him.
What did he do in England, this shady Marat? Wasn't he a dandy of the highest society who had to run away because he'd been caught red-handed, embezzling, and stealing? Didn't he smuggle himself back into well-known circles and get himself appointed physician to the Count d'Artois? Or was that only to his horses? Didn't we see him going about with aristocrats? He charged 36 livres for a consultation. And on top of that, he enjoyed the favors of certain well-born ladies.
When at last they let him jump back to his kind, the simple poor. And when we spoke and couldn't stop each word from branding him a bore. And when they found he was a quack with watered drugs and pills of chalk, and when they threw him on his back, he raised his battered head to squawk, "Property is robbery! Down with all the tyrants!"
Boss!
We are privileged indeed to introduce Voltaire, hero Candide.
We have received from a certain Marat a slave volume entitled Bell. This Marat claims in a somewhat revolutionary essay that the soul exists in the walls of the brain, and from that strategic point controls the hydrodraulic mechanism of the body by means of a network of tinkling nerve threads. At the same time, apparently, the soul is receiving messages from the mechanism of the body. Messages conveyed by piston plugs and wires, which the soul transforms into consciousness through separate sensor fuses operating A simultaneously. In other words, it is the opinion of this gentleman that a corn fills the corridors of the brain with
our laughter.
We are equally happy to welcome today the eminent scientist Lavoisier.
The Academy has received from a certain Marat some theories concerning fire, light, and electricity. This Marat seems entirely certain he knows a great deal better than the Academy. For fire, he says, is not an element, but a liquid fluidium caused by heat, which only ignites because of air. Light, he proceeds to say, is not, of course, light, but simply a path of vibrating rays left behind by light. Certainly an extraordinary scientist. He goes further. Heat, according to him, is not, of course, heat, but simply more vibrating rays which become heat only when they collide with the body and set in motion ability. It's minuscule molecules. He wants to pronounce the whole firm and fixed creation invalid, and instead introduce a universe of unbridled activation in which electrifying magnetic forces whiz about and rub against each other. It's no wonder that the author sits in his bath attempting to determine the validity of the proposition. The more you scratch, the more you itch.
This frustrated Newton's eyes
turned to the street he thought it best to join the revolutionary.
And beat his dilettante breast.
Crying out, the oppressed must rise.
He meant, of course, I am oppressed.
Woe to the man who is different, who tries to break down all the barriers. Woe to the man who tries to stretch the imagination of man. He shall be mocked. He shall be scourged by the blinkered guardians of morality. You wanted enlightenment and warmth, so you studied light and heat. You wondered how forces can be controlled, so you studied electricity. You wanted to know what man is for, so you asked yourself, what is this soul? This dump for hollow ideals and mangled morals. You decided that the soul is in the brain, and that it can learn to think. For to you, the soul is a practical thing, a tool for ruling and mastering life. And you came one day to the revolution because you had the most important vision. That our circumstances must be changed fundamentally. And without these changes, everything we try to do must fail.
Thank you.
No, no, no!
Don't take it!
Elizabeth! How you doing, Mr. Mayor?
Thank you.
but politicians crowd into his mind. He speaks to them, his last polemic fight to say who should be tribune. It is almost night.
Down with Marat!
Don't let him speak.
Listen to him, he's got the right to speak.
Long live Marat!
Long live Robespierre!
Fellow citizens, members of the National Assembly, our country is in danger. From every corner of Europe, armies invade us, led by profiteers who want to strangle us. And already, they quarrel over the spoils. And what are we doing?
What are we doing?
Our Minister of War, whose integrity you never doubted, has sold the corn meant for our armies for his own profit to foreign powers. And now it feeds the troops who are invading us.
Lie!
The chief of our army, Dumouriez.
Bravo! Long live Dumouriez!
Against whom I've warned you continually, and whom you recently hailed as a hero, has gone over to the enemy.
Bravo!
Most of the generals who wear our uniform are sympathetic with the emigre. And when the emigre return, our generals will be out to welcome them. Our trusted Minister of Finance, the celebrated Monsieur Cambon, is issuing fake banknotes, thus increasing inflation and diverting a fortune into his own pocket.
Long live free enterprise!
Yes, I am told that Perico, our most intelligent banker, is in league with the English, and in his armored vaults is organizing a center of espionage against us.
That's enough. We're living in 1808, and the neighborhoods were tried for the counter day have been deservedly rehabilitated by the command of the Emperor.
Go on, shut his mouth!
Shut up, Marat!
The people can't pay the inflated price of bread.
Here.
Our soldiers march in rags. The counter-revolution has started a new civil war. What are we doing? The farms we confiscated from the churches have so far produced nothing to feed the dispossessed. And years have passed since I proposed these farms should be divided into allotments and given farm implements and seed. And why? Why have we seen no communal workshops, which were to be started in the old monasteries and country houses? Those who have jobs must sweat. For agents, stockbrokers, and speculators. Fellow citizens, did we fight for the freedom of those who now exploit us again? We talk about France. But who is France for? We talk about freedom. But who is this freedom for? Members of the National Assembly, you will never shake off the past. You will never understand the great upheaval that you find yourselves in. Why aren't there thousands of public seats in this assembly so that anyone who wants can hear what's being discussed?
What is he trying to do?
What?
He is trying to rouse people again. Look who sits on the public benches. Knitting women. Concierges, washerwomen, with no one to employ them anymore. And who's he got on his side, huh?
Pickpockets!
Layabouts!
Parasites!
Loiter in the boulevards and hang around the cafes!
Wish we could!
Escaped prisoners, released lunatics!
Lunatics!
We want to rule our country with these!
You are liars!
Liars!
You hate the people!
We'll
never stop speaking of the people as a rough and formless mass! Why?
Why?
Because you live apart from them.
Apart.
You let yourself be dragged into the revolution, knowing nothing about these principles.
Nothing.
Has not our respected Danton himself announced that instead of banning riches, we should try to make poverty more respectable? And Robespierre, who turns white when the word force is used, Doesn't he sit at high-class tables, making cultural conversation by candlelight?
Yes!
And you still long to ape them, those powdered chimpanzees. Necker, Lafayette, Talleyrand.
That's enough! If you use any more of these pastures we agreed to cut, I will stop your plan!
And all the rest! What we need now is a true deputy of the people. One who's incorruptible! One we can corrupt! Things are breaking down now. Things are chaotic. But that is good. That is the first step. Now, we must take the next step and choose a man who will rule for you.
Dictator.
The word must be abolished. I hate anything to do with masters and slaves. I am talking about a man who in this hour of crisis
tries to incite the people to new murder!
We murder! Murder! We kill in self-defense! We are fighting for our lives!
If only we could have constructive thought!
Constructive thought!
Agitation! If only beauty and concord could once more replace hysteria and fanaticism!
Look what's happening! Join together! Cast down your enemies! Disarm them! For if they win, they will spare not one of you! And all that you have won so far will be lost!
Lost!
Sight of the fact that writing
was just a preparation. When I wrote, I always wrote in a fever, hearing the roar of action. When I was working on my book on the chains of slavery, I sat for 3 months, 21 hours a day, collecting material, dreaming of material, papers piling high, parchment crackling, until I sank into the swamps of overwork. That manuscript was suppressed. They were always ready to pick up my statements, to slander them.
Slander.
Maim them. After each pamphlet was published, I had to go into hiding.
Hiding.
They came with cannons. 1,000 men of the National Guard surrounded my house. And even today, I still wait for the knocking at the door. Wait for the bayonet to point at my breast. Simone, fetch Bah, it is urgent. My call, I must write my call to the people of France.
Why all these calls to the nation? It's too late, Mahat. Forget your call, it contains only lies. What do you still want from this revolution? Where is it going? Look at all these lost revolutionaries. What will you order them to do?
What?
Where will you lead
me?
Them? Once you attack the authorities, you turn the law into instruments of oppression. Do you want them to rule you? To control the words that you write? And repeat to you the new laws over and over until you could recite them in your sleep?
Why is everything so confused now? Everything I ever wrote or spoke was considered and true.
True.
Each argument was sound. And now, doubt.
Doubt.
Why does everything sound false?
False.
Poor old Marat, you lie posturing.
While others are gambling with France's fate,
your words have turned into a flood
which covers all France.
In her people's blood.
One day.
Wake up!
Go.
Today you have an appointment to me. There's no more time for sleep. Charlotte Corday, awake and stand. Take the dagger in your hand. Come on, Charlotte, do your deed. Soon you'll get all the sleep you need.
Now I know what it is like when the head is cut off the body. Oh, this moment. Hands tied behind the back. Feet bound together, neck bare, hair cut off, knees on the boards, the head already laid in the metal slot, looking down into the dripping basket, the sound of the blade rising, and from its slanting edge, blood still drops, and then the downward slide to split us in two. They say that the head held high in the executioner's hand still lives. That its eyes still see. That its tongue still writhes. And down below, the arms and the legs still shudder.
Charlotte, awaken from your nightmare. Wake up, Charlotte. And look at the trees.
Look at the rose-colored evening sky and put your love in bosom beams. Forget all of your worries, abandon each care, and breathe in the warmth of the summertime air. What are you hiding? A dagger? Throw it away!
We should all carry weapons nowadays in self-defense.
No one will harm you, Charlotte. Throw the dagger away. Go away. Back to Khan.
In my room in Khan, on the table, underneath the open window, lies open the Book of Judith. Dressed in her legendary beauty, she entered the tent of the enemy, and with a single blow, slew him.
Charlotte, what are you planning?
What kind of city is this? prisons are filled with our friends. I was among them just now in my sleep. They all stand huddled together there and hear through the windows the guards talking about executions. Now they talk of people as gardeners talk of leaves for burning.
Burning.
Their names are crossed off. The top of the list. As the list grows shorter, more names are added at the bottom. I stood with them, and we waited for our own names to be called.
Charlotte, let us meet together this very evening.
What kind of town is this? What sort of streets are these? Who invented this? Who profits by it? I saw peddlers at every corner. They're selling little guillotines with tiny sharp blades and dolls filled with red liquid which spurts from the neck when the sentence is carried out. What kind of children are these who can play with this toy so efficiently? And who is judging? Who is judging?
What do you want behind this door? Do you know who lives here?
The man for whose sake I have come here.
What do you want from him? Turn back, Sharp.
I have a task which I must carry out. Go. Leave me alone. Go!
Go!
Now for the third time, you observe the girl whose job it is to serve as Charlotte Corday stands once more waiting outside Marat's door. Du Perret you see before her languish, prostrated by Pardon's anguish. For what has happened cannot be undone, although that might be wished by everyone. We tried restraining her with peaceful sleep and the claims of a passion still more deep. Simone, as well as best as she could, she tried, but this girl here could not be turned aside. That man is now forgotten, and we can do nothing more. Corday is focused on this man.
No.
No.
I am right.
Right.
And I will say it once more. Simone, where is Bob? My call. I must write my call.
Marat. What are all your pamphlets and speeches compared with her? She stands there and will come to you to kiss you and embrace you. Marat, an untouched virgin, stands before you and offers herself to you. See how she smiles, how her teeth shine, how she shakes her auburn hair aside. Marat, forget the rest. There is nothing else beyond the body. Look, she stands there, breasts naked under the thin cloth. And perhaps she carries a knife to intensify the love play.
Simone! Simone. Who was knocking at the door?
A maid from the rural desert of Connors. Imagine those pure girls lying on hard floors in rough shifts, and the heated air from the fields forcing its way to them through the barred windows. Imagine them lying there with moist breasts and thighs, dreaming of those who control life in the outside world. And then she got tired of her isolation and swept up by the new age and
gathered up by the great tide and wanted to be part of the revolution. And what's the point of a revolution without general copulation?
Right. When I lie in the Bastille for 13 long years, I learned that this is a world of bodies.
Bodies.
Each body alone, enwrapped with terrible unrest. Each body pulsing with a terrible power. In that loneliness, marooned by a stone sea, I heard lips whispering continually, and felt all the time in my skin and in the palms of my hands, touching and stroking. Behind 13 vaulted doors, my feet fettered. I dreamt only of the orifices of the body, put there so one may hook and twine oneself in them. Continually I dreamed of this sacrifice, and it was a dream of the most cruelest, jealous imagine. Marat, these cells of the inner self are worse than the deepest stone dungeon. And as long as they are locked, all your revolution remains only a prison mutiny to be put down by corrupted fellow prisoners.
Prisoners.
Population.
Revolution.
Revolution.
Have you given my letter to Marat? Let me in. It is vital. I must tell him about the situation in Gaon, where his enemies are gathering to destroy him.
Who's at the door, Simone?
The girl from Gaon.
The girl from Gaon.
Let her come in.
Executed in the same old way. Won't be a mess again.
what would that be you? You're a free of Jane, you are only equal to me. But you wanted to go to what to see. To the 14 months of peace. 15 glorious years. 15 glorious years. Years of peace is a war. Greater than the year before. Marat, marching on. There must be saying in 1803, what's the finest again? So we march upon the wall, we're upon the emperor. And as the brothers of the bloody shadow, 1804, Sarah's missing, and we're on top. Yes, we are now the Prussians, which is 1806, Prussians. Let's see, to the podium and the ceremony. Fly the land and I'll see. All men wanna be free. If they don't, never mind. We'll abolish all mankind. 15 glorious years.
Just what you've achieved with your production. Who won? Who lost?
Lost.
We'd like to know the meaning of your bathhouse show.
Our play's chief aim has been to take to bits great propositions and their opposites. See how they work. Let them fight it out. The point? Some light on our eternal doubt. I have twisted and turned them each way, and I cannot find an ending to our play. Marat and I both advocate force, but in debate, each took a different course. Both wanted changes, but his views and mine on using power can never combine. On the one side, he who thinks our lives can be improved with axes and knives. Or the one who'd submerge in his imagination, seeking a personal annihilation. So, I am left with a word that cannot ever be spoken. I am left with a question that is always spoken.
In light of things, artists, gentlemen, let's quote the history book and return to 1880, the present day. A globe which not unclouded, we may say it promises mankind will soon cease to fear the storms of war, the squalls of peace. For today we live in far different times. We have no oppressors, no violent crimes. And although we're at war, anyone can see it can only end in victory.
And it must go a little.
Thank you.
and gentlemen, I sincerely apologize for the events that have just transpired. I would ask that the tragedy you just witnessed remain within the walls of the asylum and you never speak of Sharon Dahl again. Please, calmly exit to your right and left and have a safe journey home. Thank you.